Hey guys, what's up? My name is Public, and today I'm going to bring you the long-awaited Mythic Plus guide for patch 7.1.5. I know it's been a while, patch has been out for a while. I really wanted to get a lot of time on the patch doing Mythic Plus before I made this because this is a little bit harder because we had some things that really changed since I last touched on Mythic Plus for Shadow. In fact, before when I did the video then, a lot of people didn't think Shadow was in a great spot for Mythic Plus, especially on the lower keys and that sort of thing. We've gotten a lot of things in our toolkit and that kind of thing that really helped us out in all of those departments. So in this video, I'm going to be going over talents, gear, and the big other section that I wanted to hit on instead of what I did last time is just in general tips and tricks that I do for dungeons, and then also dungeon-specific info. For instance, I do something specific on this boss of this instance. So I'm going to be doing more of that kind of stuff in this video and less, general, this is how you play the class and that kind of thing. If you want that, you can check out my video I did on Shadow Priest, the guide, full guide video, which is linked in the description below. All right, so let's get started. All right, so the first thing that I want to cover in this video is talents for Shadow Priest in Mythic Plus. We don't have a whole lot of decisions in here to be made, but there are a few that I do want to highlight. Now, our first three rows of the talent tree are pretty much going to be used in every single situation. Twist of Fate, Body and Soul, Mind Bomb, these are your go-to options. My reasonings for these are pretty much the same that I said in the Shadow Guide, so you can see that there. And this is kind of where we start to get choices and options. The Lingering Insanity, Reaper of Souls, and Void Ray section is, I don't want to say it's preference here, but these are all pretty close together in a Mythic Plus environment. However, I will say for most things, especially if you have a coordinated group and you can chain pull quite often, Lingering Insanity is going to be pretty much your default option here. That being said, I know people kind of throw around Reaper of Souls and even Void Ray on some types of packs and some types of instances. I'm going to kind of leave this decision to you. For most of my testing, I chose Lingering Insanity and had great results with it. So I'm formally recommending you take Lingering Insanity for 99% of the situations, and there will be that 1% where it's like, things are dying so fast it doesn't really matter even if I'm in void form, on crazy stuff like that. And I think you'll probably know if you're in that camp and you take something like Void Ray or something like that. So again, kind of your choice there, but I would personally say Lingering Insanity for all situations. Now the next tier is pretty much only two options. We have Sandland or Auspicious Spirits, similar to what we had in the raid guide that I did before. This decision is mostly fueled by the kind of gear that you're using now, with a little bit more preference thrown in compared to what we did before. There will be a link in the post, in the description rather, that kind of goes over when to take Sandland versus Auspicious Spirits. So the one thing I want to highlight with this here is that if you were to simulate, a dungeon environment, Auspicious Spirits would win almost every single time, purely because more targets, you're going to get more procs, and you'll get more insanity from those procs because of AS. It's just kind of how those things work. So in a black box, that's what's going to be the default choice for Mythic Plus. Now, that being said, in a Mythic Plus environment, mobs die. So like if something dies in a simulated environment, it's just over. Mythic Plus keeps going and the packs are chained together and that kind of thing. There's other people hitting them and all that kind of stuff. So Auspicious Spirits, while on paper seems like it would be the best, it is one of those things where it's more RNG dependent, and especially when mobs are dying so fast, it can be kind of weird. So I would say, especially if you have a more mastery heavy build compared to crit, like significantly better, I mean, I think honestly you're pretty set up to go with Sandland instead. It's just a very consistent talent. Just a flat damage boost and is definitely a good option. So, I'd kind of, for the most part, I'd probably parallel what you're doing in raids to what you're doing in dungeons. So, let's say, judging by the post and your stats and that kind of thing, if you're running Sandland in dungeon, or sorry, in raids, you can probably still use that in dungeons too. Just kind of, like I said, take it with a grain of salt. Because as you get into the higher keystones, when things are living substantially longer, the chance of the spirit, procking and not hitting an ad goes down. Just keep in mind, with Auspicious Spirits, even though it procs, it doesn't mean you get it. You get the insanity and all that damage once it hits the target. And those spirits fly really slow. So just kind of keep that in mind. I did a variety of Sandland and Auspicious Spirits in my testing with a variety of, crit and mastery levels. And I'll say, for the most part, it really didn't change a whole lot. I just saw my overall DPS more consistent with Sandland. Alright, so the next tier, this is another one that gets a lot of attention that I see in the Shadow Discord and has a lot of, you know, interesting interactions, and that's the Power Infusion versus Misery option. The blanket rule of thumb that's going to work for most people is just if the key is above plus 10, Mythic plus 10, take Power Infusion. If it's below plus 10, take Misery. In my opinion, this works for most things, and it's a pretty good blanket rule. There's just a little bit of kind of thought you could go in to get the, you know, eke out more optimization and that kind of thing. So the main one is a lot of people assume that Power Infusion is the single target talent and Misery is the AoE talent. That is not necessarily the case. Power Infusion can do a lot of damage on AoE packs if your dots are already on them. It makes your dots tick faster, you get more ticks of Mind Flay out, all these kind of things kind of ramp up to each other. So Power Infusion, in theory, is actually good in almost every situation. So just because things die fast, it doesn't necessarily mean Power Infusion is bad. It just means it, you know, it's not as good as it could have been and that kind of thing. So, like I said, I don't do a whole lot of keys that are really low anymore, but in my testing, going above plus 10, Power Infusion is just really nice. The other caveat, and I kind of mentioned this before in my other dungeon videos, is it's not just about what level the keystone is, but it's also who you're doing that dungeon with. So let's say the other two DPS in your group are heavy, heavy trash damage, you know, but you're lacking in boss damage. Misery will not help you on the boss, right? And that's a decision you can make even at lower keystones. If you're running with two other DPS that have terrible boss damage and you really need that to finish the dungeon, take Power Infusion. You're still going to get some use out of it on trash, but then you're going to shine really well on bosses, which is a key part of Mythic Plus. It's probably like, you know, 20 to 30% of your time in a dungeon is going to be spent killing the boss, you know, and that gets even higher on tyrannical level difficulties. So, like I said, it's kind of my thing. I take Power Infusion for most things, and like I said, lower keys go Misery just to help out with that kind of thing. Hopefully that helps make your decision a little bit easier. I will say Misery is definitely the set it and forget it talent, so if you're just picking up Shadow, you could just start using Misery in everything until you get more comfortable with the spec, and then take Power Infusion from there, because it does take a little bit more skill to, you know, figure out which trash packs to use it to have it up for the boss with Power Infusion and that kind of thing. But the same thing applies. You want to get as many uses out of that talent as you possibly can. So with better optimization, you should see better results with Power Infusion. If you have questions about that, please feel free to leave a comment in the description. I answer these a lot, so I'm pretty used to it by now. All right, and then the last talent section I'll talk about is Legacy of the Void versus Shadow Crash. For the most part, Surrender to Madness is pretty much out in terms of its, you know, potential for damage. There are some people that will argue that, you know, if you're doing those boost runs where you pull, like in Maw of Souls, you pull the entire pack up until the boss, even on like plus 15s, you could surrender the entire pack and do some crazy stuff. But I feel like if you're those people, you know that you're those people. I think for, generally speaking, everyone else, we pretty much only have Legacy of the Void or Shadow Crash as options to work with. In my personal opinion, Shadow Crash just gets paled by Legacy of the Void on everything that's above like a plus 3. Or it might, that point kind of varies. I know whenever I go to Karazhan or really low keys, I'll take Shadow Crash because things just die too fast for me even to dot more than one target. So if you're in that situation, the level of the dungeon might vary based on your group. If things are dying, you know, so fast that you don't have time to dot more than one target, it's probably a time where you could take Shadow Crash. Just know that with Legacy of the Void, you're going to get just better Void Form uptime throughout a dungeon. And for me personally, I like that a lot. And that's just kind of my preference. So, like I said, Legacy is pretty much good for everything. And I think Shadow Crash for lower stones or like Karazhan runs, it's great. I think for Kara, what I usually do is up until Nightbane run Shadow Crash and then switch to Legacy for everything after that. And again, that's just my personal preference on that. One thing I will say, in the videos where you're seeing me use Shadow Crash, you'll notice I use what's called an at cursor macro, which will be linked in the description. What this essentially does is wherever your cursor is on the screen, that's where it casts Shadow Crash. So you don't have to do like, you know, click your keybind for it and then click where you want to cast it. It'll just cast it, you know, where your cursor is, kind of like a mouse over macro or things we've had in the past. So I think this is just vital for how Shadow Crash works, and it makes it so much easier to use in dungeon environments. And I highly recommend you use it when taking Shadow Crash. All right, so the next thing that I want to talk about is gearing for Mythic Plus. Now, this really shouldn't change a lot from raiding environments, especially if your, you know, whole point of playing this game is to progress in a raiding environment. I don't think you should really totally necessarily just gear all out for Mythic Plus, but for the most part, a lot of it's going to stay the same. The one caveat being, I think the two big categories of things that could change in a Mythic Plus environment are trinkets and legendaries. So I'll cover each of those things specifically, how they could change in a Mythic Plus environment. And the other thing is, a lot of people use Mythic Plus to gear for raids. So it's just in general a great source for gearing and that kind of thing. So I'm going to kind of cover all that stuff real quick. So the first part of that is trinkets. Because trinkets value does change quite considerably when you're spending, you know, 60-70% of your time of a dungeon killing trash packs as opposed to a boss. Whereas usually, you know, for raids, we're optimized to kill a boss with maybe adds coming out. So the scenario is kind of flipped a little bit. So what trinkets you that you don't see a whole lot of use of in raids actually do start to shine a bit more in dungeons. Now, there are some caveats to this. Some trinkets just stay good no matter what, and those mainly being, like, you know, your Arcano Crystals, you know, your Metronomes, and in general, just stat sticks are all very good trinkets in pretty much, you know, cross-the-board scenarios. I have this graphic kind of coming up now. I've kind of randomly placed a lot of these, but the idea is similar. Bad trinkets are kind of still bad, so, you know, Stargate, Soaring Plague Hive, and Icon of Rot don't really see a whole lot of use, in my opinion. The procs are just kind of weird on them, and I don't like the way that they work. So, in my opinion, they're not very good. The kind of meh tier that I would describe is like Bow of Corruption, Aran's Relaxing Ruby, even kind of like Whispers in the Dark and that kind of thing, because the proc rates are so weird, and you can't control it very much. So I don't really think that they're, you know, super valuable. And then there's the kind of the good trinket category, which in my opinion is stuff like Kil'jaeden's Burning Wrath, which gets a lot of value Mythic Plus. I think Grimoire from Krosis, the Faramir's Grimoire, is one of the best trinkets I've used on demand, you know, proc with, you know, a hay stick, which is great. Fury of the Burning Sky is actually pretty good as well. And like I said, stat sticks and that metronome area is also good. Kind of diving into that a little bit more. So the reason why I really like Grimoire, and you actually see me use it in a lot of the footage behind me, is that it's just a really nice trinket. You get your AoE burst as a Shadow Priest, which we really don't have without taking Shadow Crash. So it's kind of like, if you're taking Legacy of the Void, you kind of have like a mini Shadow Crash every minute that scales with Shadow Damage, which is great. If you don't know already, anything that is Shadow Damage is modified by our Paragon points that we put into our weapon. Those are the points that are above 35. As well as Legacy of the Void has a damage modifier as well, in addition to Void Form. So all these things modify Shadow Damage. So if you want to kind of see this in action, if you have a Grimoire or some trinket that does Shadow Damage, look at the tooltip when you're not in Void Form, and then go into Void Form. You'll see the tooltip actually change. So I think my Grimoire does like almost like 800k or something when it's buffed to each target, and that can crit, and it's just, it gets kind of nutso from there. So in my opinion, I think Grimoire is one of the best trinkets you can use for Mythic Plus. Kil'jaeden's Burning Wrath is kind of the same way. It's the same concept as Grimoire, except the proc is not, you know, scaled like that, so it's a little different for us on that front. And it does, Kil'jaeden's does take up a legendary slot, so there is that caveat as well. Now, a lot of people wondering why Whispers probably isn't in the good category. It shows up well in Sims and that kind of thing. Why don't you recommend it for dungeons? The main reason for that is the proc is just too inconsistent for me. I think even in raids, I don't really like it a whole lot because it is inconsistent. But when it does proc, it's pretty awesome. But that's the thing with the dungeon thing. I kind of value that flat, consistent damage, which Whispers gives you intellect, but that's the only flat part about it. So for instance, Whispers could proc at the end of a trash pack, which is like useless at that point. And I think that's just the thing that really kills me for it, is that, because that in my testing happen quite often. It's just really frustrating. So again, this is my preference. And there's a lot of different trinkets, and eye level makes a huge difference. So if you need help deciding which to use, there are some trinket resources in the description you can check out there. All right, so the next thing I'm going to cover is legendaries. So I'm going to kind of highlight each one of these legendaries that we have as shadow and kind of discuss, you know, good and bad. Whether or not you should use them is kind of your choice. There'll be a DPS chart in the description kind of going over which ones are better, which ones aren't. Keep in mind, this was for a raid scenario, not a Mythic Plus scenario, so it's not an exact science, but in my opinion, this is kind of where I'm going from here. I think for the most part, our top two legendaries in raids right now are the shoulders and the wrists. In my opinion, that does not change for Mythic Plus for the most part. Those are both really good scaling legendaries, so that means they do better the more targets there are, which essentially just makes them really good in Mythic Plus as well. So, with that being said, let's start with the top. Pridas. I think Pridas kind of got a lot of slack before it got buffed, but now it gives us a lot of great stats, and I don't think it should be, the shield should not be overlooked on something like Tyrannical. If you look at an instance like Darkheart Thicket, the final boss hits like a truck, especially on Tyrannical. He has some stuff that just does several millions worth of damage on these high Mythic Plus runs, so having a Pridas shield can be really helpful for that kind of stuff. So if you are struggling with that, or you're going into a tyrannical boss situation at a high keystone, that could be something where I would swap out, you know, the shoulders or another DPS legendary to get that shield instead to make sure I stay alive. Because if you're dead, you don't do any DPS. So keep that in mind. I cover the shoulders. Again, great legendary for dungeons. I love it. I use it for most dungeons. I'm using the shoulders and wrists right now, so that's great. Next up is the cloak that was recently added with this patch. It's okay. It's mostly a single target legendary. Obviously, it affects Shadowward Death, and it uses a proc of Shadowward Death, so having more targets doesn't exactly make it better because you can still run out of charges. And we can already proc Shadowward Death quite often, so I mean, you're only really getting the damage boost there. So the one thing I'll highlight here is the cloak can be useful for intense movement, which is kind of the nice thing about it. We already have Void Bolt, but with the cloak, you do get occasional Shadowward Death procs, to where you can also use Shadowward Death procs for movement. A great example of this, and I think some of the footage in the background, is during Volcanic Weeks. And a lot of you guys probably struggle with Volcanic a little bit, but that is something you have to learn to kind of move, you know, almost every Void Bolt, basically. But using the cloak, that can be something where you can bank a proc of the cloak for when Volcanic spawns and use that as kind of a guaranteed movement ability. So when you have to move for Volcanic, you're not losing DPS. That's the one thing I'll highlight with the cloak. Again, can be good for bosses as well, which is nice. We have the Legendary Helm. Nothing really to say here. If you're really struggling on healing, like a heavy tyrannical boss, you could swap it out. But in my opinion, it's really just not the best right now. All right. Then we have the wrists. The wrists are amazing. They're great. If you don't have them, I'm sorry. But they are an amazing legendary. And I think in dungeons, you only see the power shine even more. So, yes, if you have the wrists, I think, regardless of anything else, I would use them over any other legendary for Mythic Dungeons. Just say that. Next, the belt. The belt really doesn't help us in movement situations like the cloak, but it is a good single target legendary. So again, it's helpful for bosses, but that's about it. And that's really all I have to say about it. Sepha's Secret. This is an amazing legendary for dungeons. It really is. I can't stress enough how important, you know, stunning things, dispelling things, and silencing things are in dungeons, all three of which can proc Sepha's. Yes, dispelling things is good. I know it's kind of weird, but you might even see it in some of the footage. I do dispel quite often, and you can get that benefit of Sepha's. Now, whether or not I would use Sepha's over, say, the shoulders or something like that, that's kind of iffy. It's kind of your choice. I'll leave that up to you, but if you have Sepha's and you're kind of sad that you got it, don't be sad. It's amazing in Mythic Plus. You can essentially proc that haste thing every 30 seconds with Mind Bomb, pretty much. And stunning mobs in Mythic Plus is almost never a bad thing. So go nuts with Mind Bomb. All right. And then we have the Twins Ring, our Shadow-specific legendary ring, which I think is okay. It lost a lot of value in this patch simply because we can't really control when to use it. Before, we could kind of, you know, use Mindseer with it, but now since that's removed or whatever, it's kind of hard to stop Mind Flaying to proc it, but it can be done. It just requires a bit more effort to control and that kind of thing. I think for almost every situation, I would prefer Cephas, though, over the Twins Ring, but just know it's there. I did already talk about Kil'jaeden's Burning Wrath. I think the proc is decent enough, but I do think Grimoire has a very comparable value, and I would rather use other legendaries instead of Kil'jaeden's, especially if I had Grimoire. And yes, you can use both, but again, just my two cents. It's okay. All right, so the next thing I'm going to cover is, generally speaking, you know, tips and tricks for Mythic Plus as a Shadow Priest. So I'm going to kind of go over all the little things that I do, or, you know, augments I make to the rotation that help me do damage. And so I think for the most part, if you're, you know, just learning a Shadow Priest, you know, check out my other video on that, because the basic rotation is pretty much the same. It's just when you use certain things, it does change a little bit. So first things first, if you're struggling with DPS, the things you want to check are potion use, just like in raids, you know, food buff, flask, all these things make a huge difference over the course of a dungeon. So if you're struggling with damage, you're like, you know, I just can't break, you know, a whole lot of damage, or I don't feel like I'm doing that much. If you're not flasking and using food buff and using your prolonged powers or whatever on cooldown, that is a huge thing you can do to help maximize your DPS. So don't shy away from that stuff. It is very important. You should see me in these videos, you know, using my potions quite often, especially for those big trash packs and that kind of thing. So make sure you keep that in mind if you're, you know, struggling with damage. And the next thing I do want to cover is your cooldowns in general. So just like you want to use your potion on cooldown, don't be afraid to use things like Power Infusion, like Shadow Fiend, like, you know, Vampiric Embrace even, and especially things like trinkets outside of bosses. Some people kind of get in the mentality of, you know, adds and dungeons are trash, you know. They're literally trash. I should ignore them. That's not why I'm in the dungeon, so on and so forth. Because in heroic dungeons in the past and in mythic dungeons, you know, usually the trash was the thing that died in 5 seconds and the bosses would took the most time. But as we get higher and higher into mythic keystones, that's not always the case. So don't be afraid to pop your cooldowns on trash. That is a good thing. It's an even better thing if you start, you know, understanding the group dynamics and that kind of thing and how much damage you're actually doing as a group, to know when to pop your cooldowns on trash to have them for the boss. Because you still want to use Shadow Fiend and Power Infusion if you're taking it on the boss, but you also want to use it on the trash if you can. So if you think of the whole dungeon in kind of like a raid boss, so let's say a dungeon takes you 20 minutes or whatever. So let's say it's a 20-minute raid encounter. If you only use Power Infusion on the boss, that's like, it's just sitting there, not on cooldown. It'd be like you're fighting a raid boss and you only use Power Infusion at the end, right? That's just silly. Use your cooldowns as much as you can, especially in those big trash packs that are going to give you trouble. A good kind of rule of thumb for almost any dungeon is you can use your cooldowns for the first main pack of the dungeon, and it should be up for the first boss. Usually. There are some outliers here and there, which I think should be quite obvious. Like Eye of Ashara and Eltharion's Lair, for example, and kind of Maw of Souls, it would be kind of hard-pressed to fit a Shadow Fiend in the trash before the boss, but you could probably squeeze out a Power Infusion before the boss, the first boss. But again, this really depends on the keystone and how fast you're traversing through the dungeon, so keep that in mind. Communicate with your tank. This is an amazing tip, and I really can't stress this enough. If you're in a pug group or if you're in a guild group, it doesn't matter. You need to communicate with your tank that you need to eliminate downtime between pulls. This will help your damage tremendously. If you're constantly, you know, delaying in between pulls, not only are you lowering the time for the dungeon, but you're also really hurting your DPS, especially if you're, you know, you want to keep up void form uptime. So if you'll see in the background, a lot of times I even pull for the tank, and my tank fully understands that that's okay. And in fact, he likes me doing it because my range can be better than his sometimes based on positioning and that kind of thing. So it's definitely something you don't want to shy away from. You know, if you can, you want to keep up as much active uptime, you know, killing stuff as you can, because wasting time on just sitting there does not help you. In addition, something that can be combated quite, I say easily, but something you shouldn't shy away from is dispersion. So as you are moving in between packs, if the distance is long enough to where you're out of range and you can't pull for the tank or you can't even pull in general, that's where dispersion is really nice for. And it's something you can really use to your advantage as like a transition gap closer, so that you stay in void form in between two packs, even if they're, a little far away. So again, these are great tools you can use at your disposal. So the next thing that I get a lot of questions about is when to dot targets. So I have a couple rules that I kind of follow, and these are kind of hard to analyze, but I hope this kind of helps you get in the mindset of knowing when to use them. I will say getting comfortable with the class and the spec will get better. You'll just get better at this part the more you play it and the more you kind of understand how long mobs are living and that kind of thing, because that's the biggest thing. If mobs live forever, your dots would be on all of them. Both dots would be on everything. But because some mobs die fast, they don't get on. You shouldn't put it on everything, and that's kind of the whole strategy. So I think in general, if you have mob packs that are living in less than 5 seconds, at that, which is really really short. I mean, just think about how short 5 seconds is. For the most part, I would only dot one target and then mind flay everything. All right, which is kind of a lower cutoff. Once these ads start living a little bit longer, I'd probably, like around 7 seconds or so, I would then Shadow Ward Pain each one. And a kind of good rule of thumb is if you've dotted that first target and the other targets are still above, 70-80% health, they're probably going to be still alive by the time all your dots get put on all of them. And it's kind of my strategy with doing that. And keep in mind, you do want to be in void form as often as possible. So that's your goal first and foremost. Get into void form. Doesn't matter what you're doing, doesn't matter how many targets are up or how many targets have dots, get into void form. That's your priority. All right, so around 7 seconds or so, Shadow Ward Pain, everything. Once things start to live, longer than 10 seconds, that's when I would pretty much just dot everything with both dots. And you can kind of, just watch the examples in the video behind us to kind of see it, me doing that and making those decisions, okay? So the next thing I'm going to cover that I touched on slightly just a bit earlier is the tier 19 four-piece. So with our four-piece, we just cast void bolts at the start of void form in raids. You're taught to just, spam void bolts. That's what you do. This does not change in dungeons, in my opinion. You have the proc from four-piece, you should use it. I know everyone's like, well, my dots do so much damage. If I don't have anything dotted, then where's my damage going? You have to keep in mind, the void bolt hits like a truck. So the four-piece window is like shoving a bunch of trucks at the mobs, and that's a lot of damage. So even if every target isn't dotted, that doesn't mean you shouldn't void bolt spam during that window. And keep in mind, the reason why our dots do so much damage is because the higher stacks we get, Mass Hysteria, which is a gold trait, affects the ticks of our dots. Mass Hysteria continues to go up based on our void form. So even if thing isn't dotted, it goes off of the actual, the stacks of your void form, basically. So that is something to where even if you just void bolt spam for the 4 second window, you're still getting those Mass Hysteria stacks, so to speak, even if your dots aren't on the target. So at that point, void bolt spam everything, and then in between your void bolt cast, you can dot everything with the rules that I outlined above. So again, this is my opinion. That is the best way to go about it in dungeons, and that's what I've seen the best results with. Okay, and the last thing to keep in mind is that higher dungeon damage is pretty much directly related to longer void form and higher void form uptimes throughout the dungeon. This doesn't necessarily mean just getting high stacks. The goal is not always to get high stacks all the time, it's just to be in void form as much as you possibly can throughout a dungeon. All right, guys, so this kind of concludes the tips section for general reasons. Now we're going to go over specific dungeon information, okay? All right, so the next section, I'm going to go over each specific dungeon and what I do for each dungeon to maximize damage. So these are going to be kind of, more specific things to the dungeons. So I'm going to try to use boss names where I can, but if I don't know them, I might say, the third boss or something like that. So forgive me if that's misleading. I'm going to try my best here. So I'm going to kind of go by one in each dungeon. The two things I'm not going to talk about in this, mainly because I don't have a whole lot of footage for it and it's not really a big part of what I do in Mythic Plus right now, is Violet Hold and Karazhan. First off, they aren't Mythic Plus dungeons, so in this Mythic Plus video, and second off, it's just not a whole lot you can do to maximize stuff in those dungeons. So the first one I'm going to cover is Black Rook Hold. Most of these dungeons don't really change the talents that I would use. I think that pretty much follows the stuff up there. One thing I will say with Black Rook Hold is, before Amalgam of Souls, there's a neutral soul mod that you can tab right before the first boss, right there. It's kind of like just floating around. You should attack this to help get your insanity up. That way you can kind of focus on the big trash pack before it. You know, dump Void Form, dump Insanity, whatever. And then you can get Void Form back really fast and get Insanity really fast on that mob. It does hit a little hard, so bear that in mind. Let your healer know. Also, because I have the legendary wrists, I usually take it in with me on the fight and just keep getting wrist stacks throughout the fight until it eventually dies. So something you can use to your advantage there. During the gauntlet of Black Rook Hold, I just Shadow or Pain the bats as I'm walking up the stairs and just kind of ignore them for the most part. And then once we stop moving, I'll just focus the big fell guards there. That's pretty much it. And then one thing you'll notice, I say this on a lot of dungeons, but on the final boss here in Black Rook Hold, he does that transition phase where you have nothing to attack and you're moving around. Your dots are still ticking on the target, so that is a case where you can pop Dispersion there to keep your dots ticking even while you can't target him. You're still doing damage, you're still helping kill the boss. I've had a lot of close kills where the bosses actually died during the transition phase because of dots, so keep that in mind there. Pretty much covers Black Rook Hold, don't have a lot to say on that guy. Next I'll cover is Court of Stars. So this is a dungeon that doesn't have a whole lot of trash, really, and in fact, it's a lot of single-target stuff in general. For the most part, I think, almost regardless of difficulty, I do prefer Power Infusion over Misery, purely because it's mostly a boss dungeon. And, you know, besides the first part of the instance and a little bit in the middle, it's mostly just single-target anyway, so just my two cents there. One thing on the first boss, I believe it's Patrol Captain Gerdo or something, where you have to jump to get rid of the debuff. Something I do to help my group out, especially if we don't have a priest healer, say, hey, everyone stack close to the tank, I'll mass dispel everyone, and you can mass dispel that kind of debuff off everyone. It does help out quite considerably, especially with casters, they don't have to jump, and it's a overall damage increase for the group, maybe not for you, but it is nice, so I would suggest doing that. Last tip I have for Court of Stars is to make sure to pop your cooldowns on some of the enforcers, as generally speaking, on the first or even second enforcer, you popping your cooldowns there, you'll still have it for the boss, or if not the enforcer, the mini boss that it spawns afterwards. Just kind of my personal opinion, I like popping them there as opposed to some of the other trash packs. Alright, and moving right along, we have Darkheart Thicket. So the first thing really that I like to highlight is during the Oakheart encounter, where the roots come out, tell the other DPS, if they're okay with it, I know they might call you a padlord or whatever, to ignore the roots. If you haven't figured it already, you can dot those roots, and it will really help not only your Void Form uptime, if you have the Tier 19 two-piece, but in general, it's just a great, you know, damage increase, especially with the wrists as well. So you can double dot all of them, especially at higher keys, and for the most part, they will despawn or die before the little flowery ads spawn out of the roots. So I think, again, like I said, this is a great idea if you have the legendary wrists, if you have the tier 19 two-piece, or even if you're taking Auspicious Spirits, great overall boost. One thing I like to highlight, this is kind of a general tip, in the strip of area that's kind of watery after Oakheart and into the dragon Drasaran, it's all that watery area. A lot of people tend to have trouble with Volcanic in that area. So I would recommend, if you are one of those people and you hate Volcanic, if you turn down your water settings in the game, you can tend to see Volcanic better in those sections. So just a little tip there. Now, during the actual dragon or Drasaran encounter in general, have your tank, if they're okay with it, position the boss in a corner. If you do that, during the knockback phase, you can actually outrange the knockback and still be within range of the boss and still not even trigger eggs in the back of you. So just something, try to ask your tanks to do that. It's a huge DPS increase and in general, amazing if the tanks can do that for you. All right. Next up, we have Eye of Ashara. This is actually typically a dungeon that's kind of hated by a lot of groups, it seems like. But to be honest, with the Shadow Priest and, in general, other high boss damage guys, this is a pretty nice dungeon for us. So the first one on Warlord Parjesh. I know a lot of people say don't touch the adds, that kind of thing. I usually find it's better to ignore one of the adds and then go whole hog in the other one to help not only your DPS, but also prevent mechanics. So on the first boss, I only dot the healer add that spawns, because she does cast a heal occasionally, and that is no bueno. And then I just ignore the other add. Okay, you can probably coordinate with the other DPS to make sure they do the same too, because you don't want to kill both adds, because then you'll run into problems on Tyrannical. Okay. On Lady Hatecoil boss, if you're taking Shadow Crash or using something like Grimoire, something to keep in mind is you know when the adds are about to come out on that boss, and you can preemptively cast, you know, Grimoire or Shadow Crash to hit the adds. That way they die in a timely manner, because they do hurt the tanks quite considerably, especially with something like the necrotic affix or something like that. So keep that in mind. For the most part, the only other thing I have to say here is on Serpentrix. I think this, generally speaking, works for my group well. A lot of DPS kind of tend to focus on one of the extra tentacles that he spawns and then ignore the other one. I prefer to essentially dot both of them and then go back to the boss. This, not only do I have a lot of tentacle damage because I'm hitting both, but I'm also pumping damage into the boss as well, which is the end goal of the whole thing in and of itself. Since he does reposition quite heavily, this can affect your void form. So to combat this, you can pop dispersion during the transition and in general stay towards the central part of the platform area. That way you have minimal movement regardless of where he transports in the fight. All right, so next up is Halls of Valor. So I think one thing I like to highlight here in Halls is that Sepha's Secret is actually pretty solid here all around. I think almost every single mob pack, there's a great reason to stun or interrupt them. So if your group is lacking interrupts or stuns, you're going to be doing it anyway, so you might as well get a haste proc while you're doing it. So just thing I want to highlight here, it's a pretty awesome legendary for this dungeon. The only other things I really have to say around Fenrir, when the adds, the small dogs come out, make sure you Shadow Word Pain them or Shadow Word Death them to proc Twist of Fate. It's generally a very good practice to do. And then another thing to help your group out, and again, this does depend on the level of the dungeon and your gear. If you're on Fenrir and you get targeted by his focus ability where you're supposed to kind of run away, generally speaking, if you just pop dispersion, it should get you through the entire thing without moving. It's generally a helpful DPS boost for your group, and I would definitely recommend doing it if you can survive through it. All right, so moving right along here, next dungeon I'll cover is Maw of Souls. So with Maw of Souls, if you're doing the massive pull kind of before the boss, I don't know. A lot of people tend to pull like the entire first bottom platform together. I really do prefer. I think Misery does a great job of dotting all the targets here, and it's very nice there. That being said, Power Infusion is also amazing. The targets are generally living so long to where I think Power Infusion does beat up Misery in Maw of Souls in general, because a lot of the adds are big health. There's not a whole lot of packs other than the dogs on the boat that are very short-lived. So I think I would kind of lean towards Power Infusion mostly in this dungeon, so just kind of my two cents. One thing to say here is about Grimoire and Shadow Crash and things that have like that AoE component to them. Be careful with them, especially Grimoire. It does kind of have a tendency to pull things you don't want to, because things are kind of close quarters in that. So you just be careful if you're using that trinket or Shadow Crash. It can be kind of weird. And the last thing I'll say is on Helia, this might sound kind of self-explanatory, but make sure you have your dots up on all the tentacles at all times. This is just a Shadow Priest 101 thing. Great damage output, helps the raid, etc., etc. All right, so the next dungeon I'll cover here is Neltharion's Lair. I actually have quite a lot to say about this dungeon. The first thing I'll say is on the pack, before you jump down for the first boss, there's a giant pillar there that doesn't cause line of sight, but kind of looks like it should. So right before you're about to jump down, there's that pack of three guys. you can stay in the water and DPS them, even if you can't see them, and it looks like they should be line of sighted. So usually what I'll do here is dot them before I run around the pillar, and after they're dotted, I'm in void form, then I'll jump out of the water and do that kind of thing. So just heads up, doesn't cause LOS, so you don't have to lose DPS uptime. So right after that pack, before you get to the first boss, you jump down into the pool. There's a bunch of fish in that water. So what you'll see me do in a lot of the footage that you've seen here of Neltharion's lair is that I dot the fish and, get insanity up from them. It's easy insanity, just like the soul from the boss in Black or Cold. So you definitely want to dot those guys or get some insanity off them before the boss comes up. And the next thing also on the Rockmora encounter is you want to, generally speaking, Shadowward Pain each little ad that spawns. Not only do they kind of have to die for Tyranicar or else you'll just die to, too much damage, but it's just great overall for Shadow in general. All right, so moving quite along with the dungeon, the next thing I'll say is on Ulurag, which is the second boss. If you stand a little bit out of his platform, you actually don't get knocked back when he gets pulled, so that is kind of helpful, especially if you're opening up with Mind Blasts or something. So keep that in mind. And also during the Ulurag encounter, during the transition phase, not only can you pop Dispersion for when he's shifting around and moving the pillars to continue ticking your dots, just like the last boss in Black or Cold. Once the pillars actually spawn, I do recommend dotting a couple more than just the main one. Not only because if you guessed wrong, it is kind of nice, but also it does help your damage and to get back into void form quite significantly. And then the last thing I really have to say is on Naraxes, which is the snake boss worm thingy-majigger. Deadly boss spawns, I know it does for sure. They give you a warning for when the ads spawn. And if you notice in the footage that I have playing, the ads actually are at the top ledge there and can be DPS'd before they actually jump down. So it is something you should definitely do. At least, dot them before they jump down, and it's a great damage boost. And some of your other raiders can even ignore them entirely if you want them to. All right, so that's pretty much it for Neltharions. Next thing I'm going to go over is Arkway. Similar to Court of Stars, Arkway is a very, boss-heavy dungeon. In fact, the bosses take up a lot of time and a lot of the runs that I've done. So I usually take Power Infusion here, even towards the lower stones, just because the bosses are the big part of the dungeon here. On General Zakal, I do suggest that make sure you dot the bats when they come out. You should be aware of when they're about to spawn. DBM has timers for these, so make sure you watch that and you're ready to dot those as soon as they come out, because they do tend to die pretty fast once they do. On Korstilix or Korstilax, however you want to pronounce that, make sure you grab the little puddles on the ground. They give you haste and they're really nice. It's perfect for our class. Really, really great there. Let's see. On the final boss, the only thing I have to say here is you can usually get away with popping all of your cooldowns in the first part before he transitions, and they're usually back up by the time phase two rolls around. So don't be too stingy with those guys. Go ahead and use them. And also, this might just be a recent thing that I've noticed, or it might be a bug or something. When he hits 50% and he starts casting the transition, you notice your dots fall off there. You can reapply them before you get teleported, so that way your dots are ticking on him as you're running back, which is pretty helpful. All right, and the last dungeon I'm going to go over here is Vault of the Wardens. So, in my opinion, the trash is the hardest part of Vault of the Wardens, and again, in my opinion, the bosses are all pretty easy, especially Ansh Golem and the Eye Boss, who I can't remember the name off the top of my head. So I usually actually edge towards taking Misery here. However, when the dungeon starts to get 10 plus, I do start to wonder, again, this is all about group dynamics. Do I have a lot of boss damage, or do we need more damage on trash and that kind of thing? So I would kind of lean more towards Misery for this dungeon. Now, another thing to keep in mind, if you're taking Power Infusion, you usually can use it on the first little mini boss of the dungeon. And still have it up for the first boss, Tirathian. Just kind of keep in mind, how much damage your group does to know for sure. You should be able to see on the first couple packs whether or not that's true. All right. And for the Inquisitor boss, one thing to note is if you have the two-piece or the legendary wrist, or you're taking auspicious spirits, you can dot the little eyes that spawn that you need to look at or face during that phase. You can still dot them. The damage is insignificant in the sense that it doesn't help you kill the boss, but it can help you push more damage into the boss. All right. And that is pretty much it, guys. That's all I really have to say. I know there was a lot of tips and tricks on a lot of things, but I hope this was a better style of doing the dungeon video, and I hope you've learned a little bit. If you have questions or if you have comments on how I should do these kind of videos in the future, please let me know. But other than that, guys, everything you need should be found in the description below, and that's where I'll close out this video. All right? Thanks.